put this program together to help our neighbors get prepared, create more connected, caring, and resilient neighbors. Disaster preparedness is not just about taking care of yourself. It's about engaging with your neighbors ahead of time. You can get prepared yourself, but if you're injured in a disaster, who's gonna take care of you? And it's gonna be your neighbors. We are here for you and we want all of our neighbors prepared.
I think it's important that we identify the hazards that we're up against. We happen to be in an area that doesn't have a lot of disasters, but the disaster that could possibly be here is devastating. There is help for them, there's resources, there's handouts and things that they can do if they have questions, whether it's structural questions on their home, preparedness for their family members. Moving forward, I'd love to have you listen to my presentation. It's coming right up. Thank you very much. Like you said, I am a retired facilities emergency manager. I retired in the healthcare industry. I am not a current CERT member in Yamhill County, but I did work with Yamhill County CERT and was a member for 10 years. I did host and do several large-scale drills. So we worked with Tualatin Valley Fire, and we did a hazardous spill drill with the railroad. And so we got a good sense of what the community response would be. Are there CERT members here today? CERT is a great organization. So if you're interested in learning more about CERT, it's a great organization to be attached to. So just think about what your biggest concerns are about getting your family ready. I'm available back in the fellowship room later. You'll see me there. I have a booth if you want to come and talk to me individually about problems. I'd be glad to help you. So what are we going to talk about today? We're going to talk about what disasters are at the top of our list here in Washington County. We're going to talk about developing and understanding a hazard assessment for your area and developing a family plan. We'll touch on that. And then you'll see a presentation about emergency kits, but we're going to go over just a few emergency kit informations. And the last thing we'll talk about is resource lists. This graphic that's here in front of you is just an information graphic to kind of flowchart preparedness planning. So you have your mitigation and your prevention, which is what you're doing today. You're learning about it. You're learning whether you need to mitigate something or prevent it or fix it or plan for it. Then you've got your preparedness. And then, of course, something happens and you have your response. And that makes your recovery that much easier. So what are the top disasters in Washington County? Everybody thinks that we're only preparing for an earthquake, but we all know that winter storms are probably our biggest and most common problem. You're out of power, you may have problems with the water, it's frozen, you may have no power at all, and you may not be able to get out of your house because it may be, in my case, I live on the backside of Bald Peak. So I don't go out if I don't have to because it's icy and hilly. But there's other things. We have high wind problems, and everybody knows what happens to the trees around here during high winds. We have flooding out in the area that I live. We're close to the Scoggins Dam. So that is a real issue. And we know that if the Scoggins Dam ruptures, that it will go right into downtown Gaston. That's the prediction. Of course, there is the earthquake. We have a local crustal earthquakes that shake and can sometimes knock things around a little bit. And then we have, of course, the subduction zone earthquake. Does everybody know the difference between a normal earthquake and a subduction zone earthquake? Okay, for those of you who don't know, a subduction zone earthquake is where there's tectonic plates off the coast. The North American plate and the San Juan de Fuca plate, and they are pressing against each other. And when they do that, they start to bulge, and they just get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And eventually, which is the last time, was January in 1700, that broke, and those two plates slid under each other. That's a completely different experience than what you've had with this kind of earthquake. It is a rolling experience as things move and highways collapse because of this movement. Way more devastation with a subduction zone earthquake than you do. And there's a huge tsunami, and we all know that's a tidal wave. You saw some probably pictures of Japan and that tidal wave that came in. It's an incredible amount of destruction from things that we have been taught in emergency management that Highway 101 will cease to exist. So that's why they're taking all the schools off of the coastline and putting them up in the hills and doing all kinds of prevention and mitigation. But we don't want to just plan for that, because it may not happen in our lifetime, but it may happen next week. So it's good to be use an all hazards approach to my preparedness. So I prepare kind of worst case scenario, hope that none of the bad stuff really happens. Wildfires never used to be a real problem around here. Now they're a problem. And living on the backside of Bald Peak, it's very treed. There's a lot of logging going on. There's a lot of slash burning going to happen. And people in the neighborhoods are very concerned about that, because we've seen what happened to California. Pandemics, we've been faced with this measles situation where they're, you know, keeping people in the colleges under quarantine, because they don't want it to get loose. The other thing that comes up in Washington County is fuel, because all of our fuel comes in a pipeline that could rupture and create no fuel. Hazard assessments, that's kind of the first place to start when you want to do emergency planning. You want to kind of do a walkthrough in your house. Step one is just to identify those hazards. Anything that may cause harm to you or your family or your pets or your livestock. You decide who would be harmed. Maybe it would be just the animals. Maybe it would be just the elderly. Maybe it's just the children. Assess the risks and the probability that they're going to happen. And on a commercial way that they do this, they always take into account what kind of a impact it would have to you and the probability, and then they, you know, apply a weight to it and you kind of go from there. But at home, it's like, how old is your house? What hazards exist at home, for example? How old is your home? What's the condition of your home? And there's several vendors out that can help with looking at the codes, the year that your house was built. We've changed the seismic codes here in Oregon several times. So if your house was built after, I think it's 2008 or 2010, it's probably structurally pretty sound compared to a house that was built in 1967. What's your heat and water source? Are you completely dependent on power and water from the city? Are you on a hill? I'm on a hill. That makes a big difference. You might see more structural damage if the hill has any, it, you know, falls apart. Do you have close proximity to large water? Scoggins Dam, for example. Where are the trees on your property? Are you generally doing tree maintenance? Are you having somebody come out and look at the health of the trees and take out the branches that could fall? That's a very key thing in keeping yourself safe, is to do your tree maintenance. How many outbuildings do you have? Would they be impacted? How far are you to other resources? So your preparedness for someone that lives in this area where you're closer to resources and you could maybe walk to get groceries are a lot different from somebody who's rural and has no ability to walk to wherever they need. So it's 25 minutes for me to get to any freeway. So that changes my outlook on how I would, how quick my response would be by the outside services and what I need to do. A big one is your medical conditions. Do you have someone living at home, or are you under a medical requirement that you have medicine? Do you need power for oxygen? So all of those things create your hazard vulnerability list and helps you prioritize how you need to plan. Do you have a wood-burning stove? Is it a newer wood-burning stove? Would it survive a subduction zone earthquake? It might be a hazard more than it is a help. And then heavy objects overhead. And I have to laugh because I was teaching this and I was laying in bed one night and I looked up and I have a very large ocean float on a very large shelf right over my head. So I had to say, okay, This pertains to you, Jane, too. There's information about anchoring your hot water heater. Okay, so there's 50 gallons or so of water available to you if something happens, but it isn't going to be any good if it falls over. So there's a lot of resources to put that hot water heater, strap it in, make sure that it's safe, and then that you know how to access it if you need. So you talk about who could be harmed and how. So you identify the risk and you determine how badly you're affected by it. You're a young couple, you're in your 30s, you have no children, you're backpackers, and you would have a different risk assessment or be affected by risks different than someone my age who lives way out in the Thule buses. What will you need to have the best chance of managing until help arrives? So you can always ask yourself that question. What will you need? Extra medication? Extra power? Battery backup? Do your pets and livestock, they need to be a part of this plan. Do you have a dog, a large dog? I have two large dogs. Might not be welcome if I have to evacuate to a different location. So again, take a safety walk around your house and your property. It's very important. It isn't just your house. Do you know how and where to shut off your utilities? So you should have a very large sign that says main water shutoff, wherever that is, and everybody in the family should know how to do that. If you have natural gas, you need to be able to turn that natural gas off. And if you turn it off, you're not supposed to turn it back on. That could cause very big problems. So you have to weigh those things before you turn it off. But what happens is a lot of times things don't rupture or break until the gas is escaped, and then something happens and then there's explosions. So there are several explosions after the incident actually happens because people don't turn off their gas. So the power, the water, the electricity, the gas, all of those things should be marked very clearly. And then you need to teach family members where those are and that they're marked. You have teenage kids that are home alone until you get there. And then you should have an active fire extinguisher, and you should know how to use it. And so should your kids or people that come over. I take care of my grandkids a lot. They're always out at the farm. So I teach them how to do these things when they get old enough, of course. And if you've never let off, how many people have never let off a fire extinguisher? Okay, that can be a little intimidating. So what you can do if you want to is you can get together as a group or whatever and ask the fire department to come and show you how to do a fire extinguisher class. And they will actually set a fire and let you put it out. And it's kind of cool. So if you have a group of you that wants to get together, a neighborhood or something, check with your fire department, your local fire department, and see if they're willing to come and show you how to do that. It takes away the fear. So the more prepared you are, the less fearful you are, the less panicked you are after a disaster happens. So okay, we've got this hazard list. You decide how you're going to address it. Are you going to remove the issue, change the issue, upgrade the issue? Maybe that's not possible. Maybe your house is, you can't do it. So then you need to train or plan on how to minimize it or avoid it. So if you want to say, well, let's see, now we're just going to have to avoid it, but later we put it on the schedule for us to do something about those trees. We can't do it right now, but maybe we can do it in the fall. So make that plan and include evacuation routes for both from your home and from your neighborhood. You might have only one way in and out of your house. I do. I have only one exit, one road. If I can't get out that way, then I'd have to walk up over the hill the other. I mean, I could, but I mean, to be safe, I only have one road. Some people have lots of roads. So again, part of your evacuation routes should be part of your plan. You add that result. Do you think it's possible to plan for every hazard? No. So I always talk about plan for the worst and hope for the best. That's what I say all the time. Plan for the worst and hope for the best. Because sometimes you'll get into the middle of this planning and you go talk to your adult children and they look at you like, are you okay? What are you worried about this? Mom, are you okay? Yes, we're fine. We're just planning. So, you know, they get tired of getting emergency kits from me and emergency ladders, you know, and all kinds of, oh, Mom, it's so much fun to get Christmas presents from you. The grandkids like it. Ooh, a backpack. What's in there? Oh, you can build your own little fire. Okay, so again, assign a probability each hazard and allow prioritization and avoid over-preparing. I don't think it's really possible to over-prepare. However, I do know some people who are just adamant. You know, they got 6 years worth of food and 500 gallons of water, and that's the house you need to go to if there's anybody's problem. So identify those houses as well. There's a great handouts available to you. You can go online and look, Take 5 to Survive. There's all kinds of FEMA information out there for you. It's really much better than it used to be. So my plan is going to look different from your plan. My things that I would focus on at first are different. So you don't have to panic over it, because there's things online that'll say, for example, preparing emergency rationing. There's an easy way of doing that. You can buy just a little bit at a time, and there's I think Take 5 to Survive has a calendar, and you just take it with you to the grocery store, and the first week they want you to buy, you know, so many gallons of water. And you go down the list as you go pass through the months, and by 3 months is over, you have a fairly good preparation. And is it most important that we have water or food?
Water.
3 days. You get really sick if you can't get water. You could last for a couple of weeks without any food. I could last months. So anyway, be sure that you take a look at that. And everybody worries about how much water they have. So it's a gallon per person per day. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to pick a day and get yourself a gallon of water, and don't turn on your faucet. Pretend it's broken. And use that water for everything you do. Wash your hands, shower, clean up your dishes, whatever you need to do for that day, and see how fast that water disappears. So, it seems like a lot of water. I don't drink a gallon of water a day. No, but we use a lot of water. So that's why they say that. And I've done that. I live in a rural water district, and so once in a while something will break and they'll turn the water off. And you're eyeing that gallon. You get away from my gallon. I say to my husband, get away from my gallon. No, you can't have another cup of coffee. There's also a lot of questions about storing it. Do not store it on your on a cement floor. They say that it absorbs bad things through the cement. So they want it up off the floor. How many of you have an RV? Okay, well, there's your emergency management location right there. Your RV might work when nothing else in your house does. And we know that because we had an RV in our parking lot when we were building a new house, and that, it was horrible. It was, what, 2008, that snowstorm? My husband lived in that RV. I was at work, I couldn't get home, and he lived in that RV, and he had water and power. And so your RV is a good place to house that stuff, because that's another problem, is a lot of people don't have space for a lot of things like this. A lot of people put it in their garage right under a window, and they do that because if there's a collapse, then they can easily get to the information or the resources which are down inside. So if you, part of your plan needs to be, where is this stuff going to be held? So a family communications plan is extremely important. So you want to plan how your family will communicate with each other and where they will go to meet. So if you're a young family, you've got a couple kids maybe in high school, they're in sports, your husband stops at the gym on 2 days a week, 4 days a week. all needs to be accounted for. Make a list of where each of you are likely to be at any given time. If you can't use your cell phone, which you probably won't be able to, hopefully you'll be able to at least get the numbers off your cell phone. But the good thing to do is to have this written family plan that says on Thursday nights, Harry is at the gym until 7 o'clock. And the gym is this number, and ask for this person to get a hold of him. Now, can you use that? Maybe you'll be able to, maybe you won't. But believe me, when that hits, you are so panicked that thinking about these things, you need it written down. If your kid stays after for athletic practice, how do you get a hold of somebody to tell that person? Maybe you have a neighbor, maybe you're at work. So a family communications plan tells everybody what you're going to do and how you're going to do it, and only you can decide what that is. So consider all times of the day. That's one of the things I think about a lot. Okay, when is this going to happen? When is this next? I mean, with an ice storm, we pretty much know, you know, that what's happening. A lot of people don't pay any attention to it, but still, at least we have some warning. If the earthquake happens at 7 o'clock at night, it's going to be a whole different story than if it happens at 9 o'clock in the morning and everybody's at work and kids are at school and that kind of thing. Add neighbors, friends, coworkers that might know where someone is. So you want to have those resources. How many of you have landlines? Good job. So a landline with a analog phone, not a cell phone, not a portable phone, it won't work. So you need to have an analog phone, one of those old things we used to dial. So anyway, I have an old analog phone and I can plug it in either in the barn or in my house. You're more likely to get a dial tone and be able to call somebody there. But that also means that you need to know the number that you're dialing, and you need to know how to dial on that phone. Collect addresses and numbers of each of the places and add it to your plan, including your cell numbers. I always tell my kids we have a family member that lives out of state. They say that you'll be able to call out of state easier than you will be able to call within, because there'll be so much activity, you'll access a different kind of outward bound line if you call out of state. So we have an out of state son. Everybody's going to call him and report that we're okay. And so that if I can get a hold of them, then they'll say, oh, mom's okay. And you just arrange it in a way that makes sense to you. You know the best thing to do. There's no, you know, dyed-in-the-wool way to do this. And make copies and pass it out to people who are important in your life so they know how to get a hold of you, because they may be in the same disaster. So kind of think it through about how, gosh, we do a lot of work with these neighbors. Here's a place where maybe somebody at the church needs to know about it. Maybe here, I'm going to keep this plan at work. Say, Betty, I've got this plan here at work, so if anything happens, my emergency plan numbers are here if you need them. So when I was working and doing this professionally, I made emergency call-out books for each one of the managers, and I had them take them home. So if somebody got called in the middle of the night, they would know all the numbers I knew, because I knew more numbers than they did, because I did everything. So I took care of all the utilities, all the unsafe conditions, all the upset patients. And so when they couldn't call me, they could call another manager and that person could respond without having to worry about what they were saying. Obviously, babysitters need to know. Wouldn't that be awful if it happened while you were out to dinner or into, you know, busy and you couldn't get home? Talk about it with your kids, your adult kids, even if they think you're crazy. Just say, here, take this. This is an emergency plan. This is what we want you to do. When you get together for a family reunion, you can talk to your kids about who you're going to call. And there's also a necessity to keep a current. You can't make a family plan and then 5 years later, everybody's phone number's changed. And we're going to talk just briefly about emergency kits. There are several different kinds of kits. There's just not one emergency kit. There's a car emergency kit when you're not traveling away from home. You're just in the car driving to and from work. And what does that mean? That means that if I live in Forest Grove and I work in Forest Grove, I have a different kit in my car than if I live in Forest Grove and I work in Lloyd Center, because I'm not going to be able to get home. So again, look at the places that you travel. For women, never leave home in the winter without a decent pair of shoes in the trunk of your car. Keep a decent walking pair of shoes in the trunk of your car. Keep a coat in your car in the wintertime. Always. We just don't think this is ever going to happen. So fast forward. Again, I'm harassing my children about keeping this, and my daughter gets stranded on I-5 for 8 hours in one of those ice storms because a semi jackknifed in front of her. And she sat out there, and she said later to me, I was the only woman who could get out of her car because I had boots in my car, warm boots. She goes, everybody else was freezing. And we were just about ready to call out the mounted police when they finally got it cleared and she can get out of there. So I keep a bag in my car. It's got a pair of shoes. It's got extra clothing. It's just a simple little bag. Obviously, flashlight, gloves, walking shoes, first aid kit, warm coat, blanket. And you know, in the summertime, you might just take it out of your car. You may not need it. I keep it in there all the time, but summertime, sunscreen, sunglasses, an umbrella, some good shoes. If you're doing a lot of traveling or if you travel away to go to work, you would want to put more in there. You'd want to put a change of clothes, you'd want to put a toothbrush, that kind of thing. So the emergency supply lists, we have several handouts for those. So please look at the vendors that are out here, and you can also go online. FEMA, Oregon Emergency Management, all of those places have wonderful handouts, and you can look at the ones that best suit what you're trying to do. There's also a go kit. A go kit is something that you use when you're going to have to grab it and leave and not come back to your home. So that's a little bit different than what you plan on having at home. Extra food, extra water, because that's called shelter in place. If you live someplace where you think you're going to have to evacuate, you would want a grab and go kit. And I brought mine. It's, and you can talk to me later out there. There's all kinds of different ones. It's a lot better than it used to be. It has water in it, but you can also just get a water purifier to use so you don't have to carry around all this heavy water. Mine is very heavy. In my opinion, impractical for me alone. My husband, however, could carry it with no problem. So again, you just have to imagine that you're going to put this thing on and you're going to leave. You might not be able to drive. You may have to walk. There's emergency supply lists. There's all kinds of things that would be suited to you. Totally different list for a 6'3" healthy young person versus me. I go over to East Portland a lot. So that forces me to be a little bit more prepared because you're not going to be able to get across town. You can bank on that. And it will be months, if you're talking subduction zone earthquake, before you'll be able to get across town. All those bridges will have to be certified. So plan on not being able to get home if something like that happens when you're somewhere else. So it's just that, what is your schedule? What do you do the most? Where do you live versus where do you work? Do you not work? And really in go kits, you end up putting survival stuff in there as well, you know, the ability to cook food, things that you wouldn't necessarily have at home if you had a camp stove or something. So again, go bags are used to provide provisions if you need to evacuate. They usually provide 3 days. Today, it's 2 weeks they want you to provide for. Very difficult in a go bag. So shelter in place, supplies, prescription medications, and some of the stuff you would not think about. Baby formula, baby diapers. What do you use on a general basis or a regular that other people maybe not? So I always get the question, prescription medication, how do you gather that? Because they won't give you an extra prescription. Like, I need an extra 30 days of this medicine. Well, So, when I fill a prescription, I fill it like 3 or 4 days earlier than I'm out of medicine. And that gives me 3 or 4 extra pills every time I fill my prescription. So I put those pills in another. Now, again, you have to watch for making it go out of date. So it isn't as simple as that. But if you have simple medication that you have to take, you eventually will get yourself a bottle of medication. And you don't have to discuss that with your pharmacist or your doctor. You just do it. most doctors will say, well, I can give you the prescription, but I can't get it filled, especially if you're taking some of the more stronger drugs. If you have a serious condition, a life-threatening condition, then you need to talk to your healthcare provider about what would happen. And they may or may not be able to help you, but it's something that would go on your hazard list as something that you would like to, you want to be very careful about and make a plan for that. The interesting thing that's on some people's list is, are if you have children with you, or even just the two of you or the single person, is a book might be in your to-go kit, because if you are evacuated to a shelter, you're going to spend a lot of time doing nothing because you're not going to be able to go anywhere. So get yourself a pad and a pencil and some books, or because let's just pretend there's no electronics. That was my grandkids. You want me to turn it off? Yes, dear. We're going to go outside and look for snakes. That always gets the boys. The girls are like, ew, no! But the boys are like, okay, let's go, Grandma. Emergency kits, dust masks. I keep dust masks in my, I keep N95, I keep a box of N95 dust masks. That could save your life. I keep them in my kit. I keep them in my house. I keep them in my barn. A whistle. How long do you think you can go, help, help, help? You know, people go, why do I want to whistle? Who am I going to whistle at? Well, and again, one of the important things that's going to happen today that I hope you take advantage of is Map Your Neighborhood. So Map Your Neighborhood is a program where you get together with your neighbors, some of whom you've probably never met, and you get together with them and you talk about what you're going to do, you talk about what resources they have and what they can help you with, what you can help them with. So it's the more people you have in your group, the more resilient you are. So now is the time to call. Any person can start a Map Your Neighborhood. You just have to invite your neighbors to come over to your house and start from there. And there's lots of resources that you can talk to about starting a Map Your Neighborhood. And it really takes your resiliency, and it just really moves it up a notch. And there's a great couple in the down in the room that have, they've been putting theirs together. They've got the map up, they've got community toilets set up in people's neighborhoods, and it just takes that panic away. We're getting ready to start one in mine. It's a very rural neighborhood. We all have acreage, so that means it's not as easy to go house to house. But we also have things like tractors and front loaders, and you know, people have heavy equipment. We have our own wells and those kinds of things. It really does help you relax a little bit. And you can even go so far as to set up a daycare in your neighborhood when something like this happens, because you might have somebody who is a preschool teacher, or you'll identify the medical people that are in your neighborhood, and you can set up a clinic. And we're not talking optimal, but we're talking, you have somebody who's got a nasty cut or a broken arm or something like that, and you have a nurse that lives in your neighborhood, and you have already contacted her, and she knows that's going to be her role or his role. So identify who's got what resources and what they can do for you. It really takes emergency preparation to a new level, to a safer level, because you have this. You have a bunch of people, you know where to meet when it happens, and you go out and they have things that you can put in your window that says, I need help, or I'm okay, and they can just go by them, because it could be as ugly as you having to go to a collapsed house and see if you can find your neighbors. So, I mean, I'm not trying to scare people, but I'm trying the reality of it can be really bad. And so doing all of this helps you not panic. I'm sure all of you have had a situation in your life where you panicked and you didn't know what to do. You didn't know where to go. It has happened to me. So, oh, be sure you keep matches in a waterproof container and personal hygiene items. Nobody wants to live next to somebody who hasn't taken a shower in 2 weeks, so those little baby wipes are good. We've already talked about subduction zone earthquakes. We talked about understanding and developing a hazard for your neighborhood. That's what you do with map your neighborhood. And again, why be a part of a community response? Because it makes you safer. It allows you to help others. And I think that's just about it for me. So if you have any questions, yes.
I have neighbors who do not keep food in their homes. They eat out all the time. How do you act during an emergency? They have prepared.
Well, I would think that you would want to start map your neighborhood, and you would want to have the whole group talk about what you need. And this kind of question comes up because there's that, you know, fear that if I have all these supplies and then there's somebody else that's not supplied, you know, they're going to come to me and say, we want part of your food. And so that's another reason to know your neighbors and to say, you know, you need to provide, you need to have some backup food. I mean, and that's a difficult thing. And hopefully there's people in your neighborhood that can get together and you have to go softly with these people. You can't just say, hey, buddy, you know, you need to go. It's like in today's market. Yes. So she's asking, what do you do in the case of an emergency? Do you just stay home? Number one, you need to listen to whatever the local law enforcement tells you to do. If somebody comes along and says you need to evacuate, that's exactly what you need to do. If you don't need to evacuate, then you need to look at your own individual safety, and then you need to reach out to your neighborhood. And that's what you're trained to do, is you're trained to take care of your family first. That's first, your family, and then you go to your neighborhood and say, what can I do? I have a fire extinguisher. They want you to put your fire extinguishers out because other people may not have them. So it's first, the first law is, can you stay in your house? Is your house collapsing? Have you been able to turn off any gas or water? And so there's an assessment period of time. And then if you've done map your neighborhood, then you reach out to your neighbors. And you would probably do that anyway. There's all kinds of resources out there. It's pretty good. Thank you. Have any questions, you can see me later. I'll be here. Thank you.